Good evening, everyone. Continuing our webinar session, now we have decreased our frequency to once a week. So this week we are going to have Dr. Nirmal Patle sir as our speaker. We have panelists Dr. Unmesh Chandak sir and Dr. Dilip Gupta sir from Sevagram. So without wasting much time, I'll hand over the proceedings to our panelists, Dr. Gupta sir and Chandak sir. We can introduce the topic and the speaker in short, and then go ahead with the webinar.
Okay. Hello.
Good morning.
Hello. Good morning.
Good morning, everybody. We will be starting today with a topic of prosthetics and fixation devices hernia surgery. Now, what we want is why we need this prosthetic or fixation devices or prosthesis. What is actually happening is just tying this suturing the posterior wall of the hernia does not give you any strong posterior wall. What is happening is even after this thing suturing it, it is very fragile. Tissue can rupture again after some time, and hence what we mean, because this incidence of this rupturing is around 30 to 40%. That's why what we need is actually a fixation, something which will be there, and then it will cover the strong at the posterior wall strength. That's why we need the prosthesis. And Unmesh, you will tell about the fixation. Yes. Things.
Yes, sir. Good evening. First of all, thanks VST and ASN for giving us this opportunity to chair this session. And tonight we'll be discussing on prosthetics and fixation devices and hernia surgery. We have a dynamic speaker in Dr. Nirmal Patle, who will be talking about it. Now, as sir said, nowadays it is mandatory to put a mesh in all the hernia surgeries. Like suturing is now outdated, like in inguinal hernia surgeries in adults. So there are a lot of choices in prosthetics, and to choose from them, then cost, then the type of hernia repair you are doing, and the situation you are in while operating, whether it's an infected situation, obstructed hernia. So there are various things which determine the type of mesh or prosthesis you are going to use. And of course, in a country like India, cost is the topmost thing. So I hope Nirmal will clear our doubts about it, and we'll have some take home message, because the search for an ideal prosthesis is still going on. There is no ideal mesh yet found. So obviously there are pros and cons of all lightweight, heavyweight, all we'll be discussing now. And regarding fixation also, Nirmal will tell us about the transfacial suturing, the tackers and glues and everything. So I think without wasting time, we are on time now. So I'll hand over the proceedings to our speaker, who needs no introduction. Actually, he's a ex-secretary of Association of Surgeon of Nagpur, and he's a dynamic surgeon and a good orator, as we have seen him conduct many discussions over the years. So over to you, Nirmal.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. First of all, let me thank the organizers of VSA, the office bearers of VSA and ASN, who have entrusted me with this topic. And to be frank, this topic is actually very vast, and I've tried to cover this as many aspects as possible. And so let's begin with the topic, that is prosthetics and fixation. Friends, life is all about changes, and we have seen changes from bullock cars to the Formula One cars. And as Lord Krishna had said, when there is no change, life comes to a standstill, and that is death. So similarly, in hernia surgery, we have seen a drastic amount of change. And from the prehistoric eras, from the BCA, the before Christ eras, the Shushrutas, we have seen suture repairs, and then came the prosthesis, and now is the era of laparoscopic surgery. The very fact that what remains is the complexity of hernia. And as we all know, that there cannot be one surgery, and that is the reason we have got so many surgical procedures for hernia repair. And this is further complicated by the various types of inguinal hernias and various types of ventral hernias. So initial were the days where of suture repair, and then came the prosthesis. And in prosthesis also, we have seen a lot of changes from metallic mesh to synthetic mesh, and now the biological and the barrier mesh. So let us see one by one. The purpose of this presentation is to discuss about the various types of meshes which are available. It is actually a problem of plenty, and we have to decide which one. We have to decide which, as far as the choice is concerned, which one to choose, which one to reject. Understand the key properties of the mesh design. Now, to make a choice about a mesh, we need to understand the very basics of the properties of the mesh, which we will be discussing, which is very seldom discussed. So we shall be elaborating on that. To know how each design affects the performance and complications. Now, each mesh has got its own properties, and how it is reflected into the clinical practice, that needs to be understood. And that is how we can make a wise choice as far as a choice of prosthetics is concerned. And we shall also be discussing the different types of fixation devices, their advantages and disadvantages. So friends, what is expected from a mesh? As Dr. Gupta sir has already said, that a tension-free repair is basic prerequisite of hernia surgery these days. And it has been proved now beyond doubt that suture repair is always under tension. So we have to provide some metrics and some support to the weakened tissues, so that, and this is provided by a mesh. So to provide a biomechanical strength to the attenuated facial structures, to withstand the tension forces acting on the anterior abdominal wall during its various movements, it should provide the support in early stages of healing. It should facilitate healing by providing metrics for the fibroblast ingrowths. It should have a permanent biocompatibility. It should be resistant to infection, and it should have easy handling. There are certain criteria of an ideal mesh, Cumberland and Scales criteria, which says that it's fabricable, easily sterilizable. It should resist mechanical strain. It should be non-carcinogenic. It should not be inflammatory, or it should provide a minimum amount of, it should incite minimum inflammatory response from the body. It should be non-allergic. The basic crux is one should feel as normal as possible. There are certain additional criteria, like it should have good elasticity and tensile strength. As I said, fibroblast ingrowth, infection resistant. It should not produce adhesions. It should be resistant to mesh shrinkage, and it should be easily available and cheap. So broadly, we have these four types of mesh which are available to us. And they can be classified as synthetic. Synthetic can be degradable or non-degradable. Another is biological, which are usually degradable components. There are certain types of composite mesh, and then there is barrier mesh. Now, sometimes there is a little confusion as far as nomenclature is concerned. Sometimes composite mesh and barrier mesh are like mesh is which will have a component of non-degradable and degradable components, which are intertwined, which are knitted or woven together, and barrier mesh will have layering, multiple layers, one above the other. So there is a difference in between them. So among the synthetic non, basically three types. One is the polypropylene based, the second is polyester, that is polyethylene terephthalate, and third is the EPDFE. So polypropylene mesh, as we have been most commonly, we know that it is the most commonly used material in all our surgical repairs of hernia, be it groin hernias, be it ventral hernias. So the basic property of a polypropylene material is it is inert, it is rigid, and it is also used in woven prosthesis. The common examples are Proline, Marlex, Paritin, and Surgipro. The second is the polyester.
आपका ऑडियो गया डॉक्टर निर्मल?
ऑडियो रिस्टोर हो गया सर शायद.
आ गया अभी अब.
नाउ वी कैन लिसन.
सो द पॉलीएथिलीन टेराथलेट और पॉलिएस्टर इज बेसिकली इलास्टिक मटेरियल, हाइड्रोफिलिक. नाउ दीज टर्म्स वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग, हाइड्रोफिलिक व्हाट इज द इंपॉर्टेंस, एंड अ लार्ज फॉर वोवन मेश. द एग्जांपल्स वुड बी डायक्रॉन एंड मर्सिलिन. द थर्ड सिंथेटिक नॉन डिग्रेडेबल टाइप इज ईपीडीएफई, the expanded polytetra fluoroethylene mesh. It is rigid, hydrophobic as against polyester, which was hydrophilic. Now it has got a low integration and less adhesion formation. The common examples are Gore-Tex and Teflon mesh. Now coming to the synthetic degradable meshes. Now the commonly used were non-degradable or permanent. These are degradable or absorbable. These are basically bicryl based, commonly used as bicryl mesh or polyglactin. The degradation time is about 1 to 3 months. The Dexon mesh, it is a polyglycolic acid based, which is again degradable in about 1 to 3 months of time. The polyglycolic acid trimethylene carbolate mesh is Gore Bio A with degradation time of about 6 months. The Phasics mesh is hydroxybutyrate with about 1.5 years of degradation time. And Tiger matrix is a complex mesh which has got two components, two types of fibers. The partial resorption takes place in about 4 months of time and complete absorption takes about 3 years. Now these meshes can also be classified according to the weight. We have all heard these terms of heavyweight, middleweight, lightweight and ultralight. So the heavyweight mesh is basically weighing about 90 to 110 grams per meter square. The middleweight mesh would be around 50 to 90 grams. Lightweight mesh is about 35 to 50 and less than 35 grams is ultralight. Then according to the shapes, it can be anatomical mesh, it can be a 3D mesh or self-fixating mesh like a ProGrip, which is also available for laparoscopic and open inguinal hernia repair. Then just a mention of passing reference I want to make is about a proline hernia system, which has got two, the underlay and the onlay layers of the proline mesh, which are connected with a plug. Now friends, this is what is not very frequently discussed. We need to pay certain attention to this key properties, although a little theoretical, but of immense importance. Biocompatibility. Now, what do you mean by biocompatibility? It is basically the capacity of the mesh to be implanted without adverse effects. So what is expected that it should have least immune reaction. So mesh which is causing least immune reaction is said to be most biocompatible. Now tensile strength. This is what we all know, that it is the maximum stress that a material can withstand before breaking. So what is the minimum requirement is 32 newtons per centimeter in the strongest direction and 16 newtons per centimeter in the weakest direction. Now this is a very rarely we come to know or understand or hear what is strongest direction and which is the weakest direction. Not many companies which come up with these meshes that tell you about this. This is something related to anisometry, right? There is a direction in which the tensile strength of the mesh will be more as against to its perpendicular direction. So we need to understand which is the most tensile strength, and it should be laid according to the maximum diameter of the hernia a particular hernia defect is having. So this has got a very practical implication as to which direction the mesh should be deployed during hernia surgery. Now stiffness is basically the extent to which the material can resist deformation. Stiffness is like it will not yield, right? So that is basically stiff. As against elasticity, which is a tendency of a material to return to its original shape after being deformed. So if you can, I don't know if you are able to understand this, it's not very clear. With the increase in the strain, the stress will also increase. So a material, elastic material will have, you know, a tendency to turn into a particular shape. And when you release that thing, when you release the strain on that material, it will rebound to its origin. So a maximum elasticity of 30% is acceptable at a particular force, that is 32 newtons per centimeter. So this is what is desired while engineering a mesh. Now the pore size. We all have been hearing about the large pore mesh and the less pore mesh. What difference does it make actually? And what is the optimum pore size which should be, you know, which a mesh should be having? Pore size is basically a difference between the distance area between the mesh filaments. If you see the wound healing properties, the macrophage infiltration is possible only if the only above 75 microns of this pore size. It will also allow neovascularization and incorporation. And there is one thing which is known as granuloma bridging. I will tell you in detail regarding it. more than 1 millimeter pore size will prevent granuloma bridging. So this is very important, and this is basically effective pore size which should be at least 1 mm. The constitution or the pattern in which the structural form in which the particular mesh is prepared, that is what constitution it is. It can be polyfilament, it can be monofilament or a foil structure. Monofilament is usually preferable because of the less foreign body reaction. Now a mesh can be arranged, the mesh filaments can be arranged in a woven fashion like this, or it can be basically into a knit fashion like this. This will not have a tensile strength, this will have more tensile strength, knit pattern. Now the further evolution of the mesh, whatever the mesh design they have evolved, is basically to address these issues. There are certain issues with whatever the initial grade or generation first meshes were available, basically the heavy bed meshes. Now they had excessive scar tissue, excessive scarring. When you learn the path or the body response to the particular mesh which has been implanted, what was found was excessive scarring, was scar tissue was being generated. Second problem was basically adhesions, and that was the fact, that was the reason where intraperitoneally the meshes were not being used. And the third was it could not be, the meshes could not be used in a state of infection. So to address these issues, further development of the different kinds of meshes have been done. So let us address a particular issue one by one. First is scarring. Now the traditional heavyweight meshes have been like this gentleman after in 1950s, 58, Francis Usher, he developed this polypropylene mesh, the heavyweight mesh. Now it was with the idea to provide a secure and a respected long lasting repair. But as the the research went on, the question arose whether they are being over engineered. So how to decide? So the research went into such form that what is the normal intra-abdominal pressure in various activities. Now if you see this chart, the sitting it is 14 mmHg, squatting 16, staring staircase 53, maximum generation is up in about coughing and jumping. The range could be 75 to 250 millimeters of mercury, but the average is less than 150 millimeters of mercury. So this is the intra-abdominal pressure which is generated from inside onto the anterior abdominal wall, and that should be taken care of. And when we studied the meshes, these heavyweight meshes, the lightweight mesh would have a capacity to withstand about 650 mm of mercury pressure, and the classical polypropylene mesh would bear a pressure of about 1650. So from maximum which is required of 150, it is being provided. So it was an overkill kind of a thing. So this led to the concept of having a lighter weight mesh. So how to so before we can do that, we should understand how basically scar formation occurs. So if you study the pathophysiology of the wound healing, it is basically the initial phase of cellular infiltration, and there is later on infiltration of the generation of the soft tissue matrix. So collagen matures, myofibroblasts they contract, and the contraction is up to 50 to 90%. More is the inflammation, more is the tissue contraction, and basically more is the because of the and that is because of more foreign body implant. So mesh implant, whatever is shrinkage, we frequently hear about mesh shrinkage. It is not about the mesh which shrinks, it is basically the wound which contracts. And the more amount of foreign body available, more would be the wound contraction. So more would be the mesh shrink, and more the mesh shrinks, the chances of a hernia recurring is more. So this is a very a classical representation of a polypropylene or the classical propylene heavyweight mesh, and this is a diagram of an ultra pro mesh. So what is happening is this is basically a small pore. Heavyweight mesh will have a small pore. If you look at the diagram, if it is magnified, this is the inter filament distance, the distance between the two filaments. If it is magnified, this is one filament, this is another filament. Now any filament will, the healing would be by micropipe infiltration, the giant cell formation, and after that the foreign body granuloma formation around each and every filament. So once this granuloma form, and if the distance between two filaments is less, there will be bridging of the granulomas. Now this is a classical feature which has been found to cause a final, you know, outcome would be a scar plate which is non-elastic and it is extremely rigid. So the patient will have a heaviness, or you know, khichav jo bolta hai patient ki, rigidity of the mesh, the elasticity and the mobility of the anterior abdominal wall is restricted. As against another lightweight mesh, for example ultra pro, which will have a large pore size and the interfilament distance would be more, the same amount of granuloma will be formed around each and every filament, and because the distance between the filaments is more, there would be no bridging of the granulomas, and the end result would be a scar mesh and not a scar plate, and this scar mesh will be more elastic rather than a rigid scar plate. So this is basically the crux of development of basically lightweight meshes. Let us see. So the question was to reduce the amount of foreign body and yet have enough strength. So you can have thinner filaments with more tensile strength, or you can, how to do it? You can also incorporate absorbable elements which disappear over time. So this is basically the concept of a composite mesh, which will have some part of degradable absorbable element and some non-absorbable or non-biodegradable element. So this is the concept. This is where the concept of generation of a composite mesh arose. Another was to increase the pore size. The eventual pore size would be 2 to 5 mm. Now the large pore size, when we see it, as we saw, would lead to a flexible scar mesh and a greater elasticity, and this is basically following incorporation of instead of a rigid scar plate. As we said, it will provide a better wall, abdominal wall compliance and a more patient comfort. And if we see by the process of healing by collagen, initial proliferative phase, and then there is a maturation phase where two types of collagen, type 1 and type 3, are laid down. Healing collagen type 1 is basically a characteristic of a mature scar or fascial tissue, whereas type 3 collagen is mechanically unstable with less cross linking of the collagen fibers, and it is found in the early part of healing. So in a final mesh tissue which will have more collagen, type 1 collagen will be more stronger, and it will not lead to hernia recurrence. In patients with recurrence of hernia, what was found that the collagen 1 to collagen 3 ratio was basically low. So eventually a lightweight mesh has also been found, that lightweight mesh will lead to less tissue reaction with deposition of more type 1 collagen. So this is basically what led to lightweight meshes like paratin mesh by Covidien, which is a monofilament polypropylene mesh, the ultra pro mesh by the Ethicon, and the Vipro mesh, which is again a composite mesh. Vipro 2 mesh, Vipro 1 was associated very high recurrence rate because it was very weak. So it was re-engineered, and Vipro 2 came into it, and there will be degradation of the vicryl part and the proline part would stay. Now the second issue. Now first was the scar. We understood that how a scar is formed. The second issue was basic because of the adhesions. Now, why do the adhesions occur? It is basically the ingrowth of the fibroblast, you know, fibrosis. You know, we frequently say they're both fibrosis time. So what is there is basically the fibroblast ingrowth. Now on the parietal side, now just imagine we are operating on a case of intraperitoneal only IPOM repair for a ventral hernia or incision hernia, where the fibroblast ingrowth into the tissue is desirable on the parietal side. Whereas on the visceral side, it is not desirable because it will lead to adhesion formation. It will erode into the viscera, be it bowel be it the omentum. Fistulization will occur, and patient can also have intestinal obstruction. So now this is a very tricky situation where you want to have the fibroblast improve, and you also don't want to have it on the other side, right? So the concept of barrier mesh care. Now adhesion, as a as a part of adhesion prevention strategy. Now, even the barrier mesh, you know, a combination of a polypropylene or polyester and synthetic mesh, and it is coated with a bio with a barrier which will have an anti-adhesive properties. Now, depending on whether this barrier is basically having an absorbable or non-absorbable, this can be of various types. Let us see. Now, again, a lot of research went into this, and the companies, the industry, they came with a lot of options. Now, there was sudden, you know, outflow of various types of mesh. So we will study one by one. This is the parietics mesh. The parietal side or the non-absorbable side will have a polyester mesh, polyester component. The visceral will be collagen or polyethylene glycol or glycerol. The longevity about 20 years, and it was by Medtronic. The again a very popular mesh was, I would say, Proceed mesh with a polypropylene and a PDS ORC, polypropylene on the parietal side and the PDS ORC, oxidized regenerated cellulose, on the visceral side by Ethicon. Sepra mesh was also available by Deval. It also was combination of polypropylene and hydrogel on the visceral side. Secure mesh, again polypropylene omega-3 fatty acid by Atrium. ProVisc, it is still available by Lotus. It is basically a polyester mesh with polyurethane film on the visceral side. Now Gore developed dual mesh, which was EPTFE both sides. One side it was rough and one side it was smooth. Now EPTFE is a special structure. It can have, you know, large pore on the parietal side and a small pores on the visceral side. The large pores would, you know, invite fibroblast and formation and regeneration of a scar. Whereas because of the small, very small pores on the visceral side, there would not be any ingrowth of any tissue, so thereby preventing adhesion formation. Composite mesh was there with polypropylene and PTFE by Bard. And tie mesh, this is a recent addition, not very recent, 3-4 years have elapsed. With the tie mesh is basically a polypropylene mesh, but it is coated, each and every fiber of polypropylene filament is coated with a titanium coat. All right, but mind you, this titanium is not an anti-adhesive, but still it is being promoted as a for intraperitoneal use as well. Now these all we know: Paratics, Proceed, ProVisc, Physio Mesh, Secure. They all are colorful and they are all, you know, attractive. So whenever a new product is launched, you would have seen that company people would come to you and they would present it as if it is the final thing in the hernia processes. But as you know that this Proceed Mesh and Physio Mesh are already off market. For various reasons, this was associated with a lot of adhesions, and this was Physio Mesh was having a lot of recurrence rate. So there was a voluntary recall of this both the meshes by Ethicon. So we have to be very careful, right? Now these are with all the absorbable visceral layer, and this is Gore-Tex and Composites are with the non-absorbable visceral components. Now the third issue was basically infection. So we wanted some processes which could be used in presence of infection. So what was that? So infection, how did it develop? So this was a basically template or the requirement over which the biological meshes were developed. Now biological meshes are all basically collagen based meshes. They are decellularized collagen based meshes. Now collagen is present in all the tissues, all the soft tissues. So whatever they have, the classification of basically biologic mesh is basically depending on from where the primary collagen is extracted. So this can be allogenic, human-based. The human-based dermis is the most commonly used. The various mesh which are available are Alloderm, Allomax, and Flex HD. The xenogenic materials, porcine dermis or porcine intestine. The porcine dermis, the examples would be Zenmatrix, Stratis, Permacol, Colamed. The porcine intestine, Sergesis. Now we have all used, many of you must have used Sergesis mesh. So Sergesis was the, probably the first marketed, or I don't know, that was our first acquaintance of biological mesh. And to continue with the xenogenics, even the bovine dermis and the bovine pericardium has been used. The surgiment or the pericard, the pericard is basically a bovine pericardium based. Viritas and tutupas are the rest of the examples. Now, if you see the principles, the synthetic mesh physiology or wound healing is different from biological mesh. The biological mesh does not have this classical, you know, early and delayed phases of wound healing. As against to scarp mesh or scarpet formation in synthetic mesh, the biological mesh, it undergoes remodeling. Now, remodeling is basically, you know, to provide a matrix till initial healing, and that matrix eventually regenerates into a native tissue, right, through a process of incorporation. A new fascia or a new tissue similar to the original host is basically created, and once it is created, the biological mesh, it will eventually degrade. Now, the reconstructed tissue, it tends to resemble the original specific tissue, the in situ, or the histologically as well as functionally. So this is basic difference between a synthetic healing from a biosynthetic mesh and in a biological mesh, right? So basically, as I said, collagen, it is basically collagen rich tissues that are harvested and then decellularized. The process of decellularization, it is basically the, you know, of prime importance in a biological mesh, because it will prevent inflammation, or it will prevent rejection or inflammatory response, right? So basically decellularization, and then what is available is basically a collagen rich tissue. And whatever advances have been made, as against, you know, example, if you take surgesis, now it is bio design, I suppose it has been now developed into a bio design kind of with a rename as bio design. And it has been, you know, re-engineered or further refined. What have they done is, like, they have taken up the lipid component of the surgesis mesh, and they have further decellularized, and then again a better product is available as biodesign. So the concept of mesh engineering is basically to meet the surgical needs or the clinical demands, right? And this is the very particular quality or the property of a biological mesh, which makes it, you know, ideal to be used in presence of infection, because it has been decellularized, right? And it will eventually degrade after generating the new fascia, which is very much similar to the host tissue. Now, having studied all the different types of meshes, having said everything, whatever advances have been done, the complications associated with mesh have always been there. Whatever type of barrier mesh you use, there are going to be adhesions, there are going to be complications of bowel obstruction and perforation, infection, mesh rejection, mesh migration, recurrence because of the improper use of the mesh, and chronic pain. We will not go into the complications of per se, because the topic is more restricted to the prosthetics. So how to, you know, and these are the complications which had led to hernia mesh recalls. Now, the atrium secure mesh was recalled, the barred mesh was recalled. The atrium was recalled because of these sterilization issues, the barred composites was because of adhesions, even the crucid was recalled because of the adhesions, and the physio mesh was because of the recurrence rate. So whatever company people will tell you, you have to be very alert. You have to study the long-term results of a particular mesh, and then only you can trust them. So how to choose a mesh? The basic purpose of all this discussion is to how to implement them in clinical practice. So for an inguinal hernia, open repair, if you see a non-complicated inguinal hernia, prefer a monofilament large pore lightweight mesh. The example would be Paratin Light or Ultra Pro. And if it is a complicated hernia, you know, strangulation is there, some infection is there, and absorbable mesh can still be used like Vicryl mesh. Laparoscopic repairs, we have again, the sizes would be different, but again, monofilament lightweight meshes can do. In case of a ventral hernia, barrier meshes are to be preferred. Basically, little to choose. We have all used proceed mesh. We have all used physio mesh. But after that, what basically are available and are basically paratex, provisc, or symbiotex mesh. So you can use any of them, little to choose in between them. And basically, initially it was a problem of plenty, but you can still zero in after you understand the basic pathophysiology. So as far as the mesh is concerned, as Dr. Unmesh Chandak sir has already said, that an ideal mesh does not exist. New creations will continue to be there till we find a perfect one. And please never get carried away by the industry. Right? So we can we continue with the fixation part and then we take the questions, or Unmesh sir? Gupta sir?
Yes, sir. Complete your complete talk. Please complete.
Fine. So we will go ahead with the fixation now. Now, whenever the mesh is used, automatically comes a fixation device. You cannot leave the mesh like that, except for in selected cases we will be discussing. Again, with the, as was the problem with mesh, the same was with fixation devices. Which material to use, which type of fixation to use, what are the different, articulating, non-articulating, it led to all confusion. And that is a basic, purpose of this discussion. So what is desirable? Why do you want a fixation? What is expected of a form of fixation device? It is expected that it should prevent mesh migration. It should reduce recurrence. Thereby, it should be inert. It should be adhesion free. All right, it should not have further complications. Now, the fixation types can be basically sutures. Now, suturing can be a peritoneal suturing or a transfacial suturing. It can be staplers, it can be tackers, it can be endo anchors or a glue. Now, it can be glue, can be, fibrin sealant or a cyanoacrylic. Now, let us see one by one. Depending on, we can further classify depending on what kind it is. The fixation devices can be non-absorbable. It can be metallic or it can be, synthetic. The initial was the endo anchor by the J&J, then came the solute or the Q fixation, then the Protac, it is still used, we have all used, we have commonly used, then came the synthetic material of a Permafix and or a Fast Touch. Now Fast Touch is one which can be non-absorbable as well as absorbable. Now absorbable can still be, these are all the various different types: absorb tag, secure strap, Sorvafix, Fast Touch, absorbable, or an OptiFix. Now, why did so many come? Because nothing was found to be, ideal. Now, if you see the designs, they can be there are variety of different shapes. And Sorvafix and Permafix can be, they again came with a hollow, structure. According to the shape, they can be helical. They can have anchor, screw, strap, or Q shape. We have all seen these. And according to the fixation type, according to the firing angle, it can be straight or it can be an articulating type. Now we always face with the ipsilateral, contralateral side of fixation of a mesh in intra IPOM repair is very easy, but we actually face difficulties in cases of ipsilateral position. So for that, the industry came up with the articulating type of fixation devices. Special fixation, it is the most type of fixation, nothing beats it. But then it was associated with, the initial practice was to use it to tie it very tightly, and what it led to was basically the ischemia and ischemic necrosis of the tissue which was entrapped in between the suture, and this further led to hernia formation. So for fixing the mesh, you have used a device and then it had led to complications like hernia formation. The second would be, a typical device of a fixation device would be like this. It will have a handle, it will have a trigger, it will have a shaft and a firing tip. So the most important step to, fire is the firing tip should be perpendicular to the abdominal wall, so that a maximum, penetration of the tissue or maximum purchase of the soft tissue can be, gathered and so that am I visible?
Nahi, your figure is gone.
Okay.
Your webcam has
stopped. Now you come back. Yeah.
So particular fixation device would have a hand, the firing tip. Now the firing tip, it is important to have, you know, a perpendicular firing at the abdominal wall. Now this perpendicular firing at the abdominal wall will ensure that the penetration fixation device, whatever it is, right? Sorry for this, a little complicated or little crowded slide, but this is basically a summary of whatever options are available. So a typical relay tack it comes in two designs. It is basically a screw based model with a height of about 5.1 mm. Each 5.1 can be 1 mm can be articulating and a non-articulating. Now the polyglycolic acid is the absorbable material which is used. Now this is the design. Similarly, the articulating tack can be absorbed tack or a non-articulating 5.1 mm screw, again the same material. So this is basically absorbed tack. Now the pro tack, which we commonly use, is basically a helical structure, and it has it is about 5 mm in length. And it is composed of a non-absorbable titanium material. This is the Sorbafix. The height, it is again a screw pattern with a hollow structure. This hollow structure is basically to allow the tissue in growth so that more purchase or more strength of fixation can be achieved. It is again non-articulating. Seeker strap by Ethicon is anchor like structure. It is basically two point fixation with a 7.2 mm strap length, again non articulating. And finally, this is a liquid band fixate glue, a cyanoacrylate glue. So we see that various depths of tissue purchase, various designs, and two point fixation or a screw fixation, these are all available, absorbable or non absorbable. So this is basically what are the choices which are available, how to select which one. So what will determine the strength of fixation? Is it the material? Yes, a permanent helical tack like a protac will have good stronger fixation. Length wise, if you see, the common sense applies that more the length of tissue penetration, more will be the tissue purchase and more will be the fixation strength. Mechanism of firing, yes, the mechanism of firing, whether it is the articulating or a straight fire, and the mechanism of fixation, whether it is a two point fixation or it is a spiral fixation or it is screw type of fixation. Now we have all, there are lots of studies have gone, and to sum up, I would say that it is not directly always related, like to length. If you see, the length may not be directly proportional to the burst strength. It is basically a tissue contact. Now, a tissue contact, if you see, a screw type of a fixation will have a more tissue surface area, which is, in contact with the tacking device. So it can still, even if it is having a lesser penetration into the abdominal wall, it can still have a more hold. So that is basically what decides. And basically, how have you fired it? If you are not firing it perpendicular, if it is going obliquely, then it will not have much of a tissue hold. Now, all these fixation devices, whatever you use, they are not without complications. So, what are the complications? Again, adhesions. Any foreign body into the peritoneal cavity, it will have adhesions. Not only it will have adhesion, it can erode. Now the erosion of the small bowel, colon, as well as gallbladder has been very clearly, recorded in the literature. Chronic pain is one thing which is very commonly associated with all the types of fixation devices, and this is basically what led to from a metallic to a biodegradable or a fixation devices. Now it can also damage the mesh. my personally you know faced this complication where the attacker went through and through the mesh, and I had reported this as well. Even hernia site recurrence because of the excessive amount of pressure or the mesh at being very much stretched out and then being fixed, it can all lead to hernia recurrence. So maximum of these complications were because of the intraperitoneal exposure of the tacking device, which was in direct contact with the viscera. So one option which came up was you know, a cap, this tacking device having a cap of PEEK, that is ether ketone capsule. Another type of, so this is all foreign body, which will, you know, all these fixation devices will have a foreign body reaction. They will generate inflammation, they will generate pain. So the researchers, they came up with the option of having a glue. Now glue can be a fibrin glue, which is biological, or it can be a cyanoacrylate glue, which is synthetic. Now glue will have a non-inflammatory adhesion of the mesh to the parietal wall, and that is the reason all the glue fixations, they have less pain or minimum pain, and which is statistically significantly less than any of the fixation devices which have been discussed earlier. Now fibrin glue, there is a difference between the fibrin glue and the cyanoacrylate glue as well. Now the fibrin glue fixation will have, you know, excellent local tolerance and lack of adverse effects. It acts both hemostatic and sealant. Whether you need the hemostatic effect is a different topic. It is bioabsorbable, non-associated with inflammation and tissue necrosis. The efficacy is comparable to that of tackers, less neurological pain, less incidence of seroma. Now, if you see when a glue is spread over the mesh, it will not have a point fixation. Now, rest of the tacking devices will have point fixations, whereas this glue, whatever, either fibrin glue or a cyanoacrylate glue, it will have a uniform, you know, adhesion of the mesh towards the abdominal wall. So the incidence of maybe seroma is also less, and reportedly less expensive. Cyanoacrylate glue will have, as compared to fibrin, will have more inflammation. So better fixation than a fibrin glue, less pain than tackers. I think further research will, you know, tell us whether it can still replace the tackers completely, right? So how do we decide? Okay, so if we see the ventral hernias, whatever literature is available and whatever the material, the fixation devices are available with us, whatever the studies, I would say that for ventral hernias, if you're using IPOM, then use absorbable tackers in a double crown method, outer ring of tackers followed by inner ring of tackers, and at least 2-point transfacial fixation, which is not very tight. It should not cause pressure necrosis. It should be tied very gently and loosely, so that the purpose would be, you know, to prevent mesh migration, and at the same time, it should not have any tissue necrosis. For inguinal hernias, as far as TAPP is concerned, 2-point fixation is advisable, laparoscopic repair. In TEP, fixation is not advocated except in cases of large direct hernias. As far as open groin hernias and open ventral hernia repairs, we all use, you know, polypropylene sutures. Even tackers are available for the open hernia repair as well. Now, if you look at the future in cases of fixation devices, prostheses which will respond like an autologous tissue but still provide permanent adequate strength would be, you know, desirable. Prostheses which are impregnated with antimicrobial agents, which have a barrier to bowel adhesions, which are resistant to infection, and glue fixation just might come in a big way to provide all these solutions, right? So with that, I think we can start with the discussion. Thank you so much for your patient listening. Yogesh?
Yeah, our panelist can start the discussion.
Hello. Dr. Nirmal. Yeah, Dr. Nirmal.
Yes, sir.
We have one thing. The thing is, now the 3D devices have also come, which are called a non-toxic or non-fixing meshes. We say we don't have to use any tacker or any fixation device for this. What do you say about this?
Sir, there are self-fixating meshes are also available. I don't know how did I miss that. I prepared that slide as well. 3D mesh and self-fixating meshes are also there. Now, the self-fixating meshes would be basically a polyester, like Lapro grip mesh, which is basically a polyester-based material, and it will have some tentacles. A 15 by 15 mesh would have some infiltrating tentacles, which will be, which will help in self-fixation of the mesh to the muscle. Now, these tentacles would, can still be numbers about 5,000 in a area of about 15 by 10 or 15 by 15 mesh. So you don't need to tack. You don't need any fixation devices in such cases. Similarly, with 3D mesh or anatomical mesh, even those options are available, which will in a laparoscopic repair, it will adapt to the contours of the medial fossa and the lateral fossa, and it will have a deeper penetration into the medial fossa and lesser in the outer one. I had prepared this. I don't think did I miss it or no? These materials. Yes. Okay. Anatomical mesh or 3D mesh, and what I was saying, a self-fixating mesh for even open repair with a slit for the cord. We have this option of pro grip mesh in open inguinal hernia as well as laparoscopic repair of groin hernias.
Okay. There was a pro device. We can say it is a flower type device, which we say just put it beyond at the side of the cord and leave it as such. So there is no need to fix anything. It's a small device. We do not do anything to the posterior wall. Just leave there at the inguinal canal.
Sir, yeah, I fully agree. There are lots of devices. Even the PHS system was there. Even the flower and plug method was there. You just plug the... So many of these devices were beyond the purview of this presentation, so I did not cover them. But yes, you're perfectly right that you have these flower-based or flower-shaped devices, which are also indicated for hernia repair.
All right. It was a very nice presentation that way. We can say that, as earlier I had discussed, there is no ideal mesh. Because we can say the properties which we have already seen, every mesh does not show a full property which are there, like it should be macrophallus, monofilament, rash infection. Something or somewhere, there are things are there. So,
correct.
Nice discussion about it. We have gone covered, I think, very widely covered everything about fixation and then the meshes. Now, let us have questions from the audience. Unmed, if you want to have some, you can ask, and then we'll have audience questions. Right.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Nirmal, for an elaborate talk. It was really difficult to cover such a vast topic. But a few things which I want to tell, that more than anything, the point which cannot be stressed more is the technique. Irrespective of the mesh you use, the size of mesh which you use is very important. And technique, by that I mean, say in inguinal hernia, you are doing TEP. If you are not taken the peritoneum down till the vas turns medially, the peritoneum might enter anterior to the mesh, and irrespective of the quality of mesh or whatever mesh you use, there will be recurrence. So still technique and the experience of the surgeon plays a major role. And one thing from a surgeon's point of view, what we can do to reduce the confusion of so many meshes, that you can standardize a procedure and follow one procedure for, say, inguinal hernias. Say I have been doing TEP all these years, I never do TAPP. So, or same will be for TAPP if somebody is doing that. So by that, what you can do is you get to understand what mesh suits you, what are the problems in spreading the mesh, and the long-term follow-up of the mesh. So it definitely reduces the confusion. That's what I feel. Otherwise, excellent talk, Nirmal. So I think we can take few questions. Yogesh?
Yeah, we have Dr. Rahate sir, and then Dr. Prashant Bhote sir after that. Rahate sir, please unmute your mic.
Yeah, Nirmal, it was very good talk. I just wanted to ask, I just wanted to have one query about the self-fixation meshes. For how much time that mesh can be adjusted locally, how much time it can be removed, and then it can be attached to the tissues?
Sir, more than 3-4 times, even whenever I have used, I have not found it very difficult to, once you have laid, and again you have to readjust the position of the mesh, especially in TEP, then you can still do it. It is not like that it will immediately get adherent very densely. So making the, your further maneuvering of the mesh or replacement of the mesh difficult. It can still be done, but yes, it requires a little technique, proper unfolding of the mesh, and you know, you should be very clear regarding the medial side and the lateral side, and then you can still do it. Very much manageable, sir, not much difficult.
Hello, Dr. Rahate?
Yeah, Rahate, sir. We have next question from Prashant Dhote, sir. Prashant, sir.
I think the audio is gone. One of the audience, there is a question, unanswered question, I think it is showing.
Yes,
Subhashree? Yeah.
Pradeep Arora, sir, please ask your question.
Okay, I will ask question. Dr. Patle,
sir,
there is a type of mesh which is indigenous, discovered in our country, pioneered in our country, and world over it is being experimented upon, and the studies results are not all that bad. So in spirit of Atmanirbhar Bharat, I think you should have mentioned that also.
The Sardas technique, you mentioned?
Mosquito net.
Mosquito net.
Okay, sir, how many of us are using it?
We cannot laugh away, Nirmal.
No, sir, how many of us are using it?
And I will tell you
how many of us use it, how many of us not use it. The question is that how a scientific mind should not laugh away and trivialize any, you know, idea. And you know, in other countries it has been tried, it has been studied. There are systematic studies which have been published in prestigious journals with good impact factor, and the studies are quite encouraging, and it is becoming more and more popular in low resource countries. So in one of the studies which got published in Hernia 2018, I suppose it was a systematic study, and it involved a study on ventral hernia. Around 360 cases were culled from various sources, and it showed that it had, the results were quite comparable to commercial meshes, to other commercial meshes like of the like of Wipro and UltraPro. So the results are quite comparable. No, so it should be looked into, it should be remembered, it should be mentioned, and it should not be disregarded, because it has got interesting possibilities. Only issue about you know, this mesh is that of sterilization. There are studies that it would be hard to sterilize at 121 degree minimum that is required to sterilize these meshes. It destroys the architecture of these meshes. But there is only one study, you know, which says that. Most of the studies are quite encouraging in this respect too. So it's a very interesting thing, and that should not escape mention, because
I'll update, sir. I'll update my presentation.
I think most of us know about it. Most of us know, but then it is you know, mentioned jovially, as if it's.
I have myself also used this. I have myself used this, so I am aware.
Oh, yes.
Yes, I've used it.
I have not used it because I am not sure about the sterilization. I thought I will ask you some question regarding the sterilization, whether, but you didn't mention it at all. So I will ask those questions which are down to earth, you know. What about, you know, sterilization of meshes which are left in excess, and sometimes surgeons, for the sake of economy, it's not a bad thing, are tempted to reuse after sterilization, right? After sterilization. So is it safe? Is it, of course, you know, it's not oftenly mentioned in the textbooks, but some people do practice it. I have seen that they get a big mesh, then they, you know, make small segments of it and then use over several cases just to save money. So what do you say about the sterilization? How to sterilize these meshes?
Sir, PTO would be the best. If suppose, like, obviously it is not you know, indicated, But even if for some conditions, if we go for it, then ETO would be the best method of sterilization.
I think what we have seen is gamma sterilization is available most of the cities, big cities. So if we have available, we can go for gamma sterilization also. That will be much more better.
No,
meshes are the gamma sterilized.
Most complicated thing would be available. Tell me the least demanding, you know, way of sterilizing it. Can you sterilize it by heat? Can a surgeon do it in his own nursing home, sterilizing it by heat in the autoclave that is available? That would be a useful question to answer.
No.
Yes. Big gadgets are very, no. I mean, very easy to
ideally,
answer
no.
in terms of big gadgets. No, ideally, no. It is whether it is possible or not, because people are doing it. Eh? Okay.
No, sir. We do not have the literature
We are treading into unfamiliar terrain when we say that. We are treading into unfamiliar terrain. We don't know actually whether it is okay or not. Then lastly, that always fascinates me. Dr. Mishra of RNA Institute, he uses meshes. And that's what I need not complete my question after this. What do you think about that?
Intracranial. Yes. He has got published results. His results, he says that there are, you know, no complications or acceptable complications of mesh adhesions and bowel obstruction and erosions.
Yeah.
But as far as the global literature is
concerned, my question is yes, you are just explaining it. That are these results reproducible in other hands too? Are there other workers too in that have come in your study? Well, you must be prepared for this topic. Did you come across any references which support this view? Hello.
Yes.
Hello, Nirmal. You must have studied this subject as you were preparing this. Did you come across references supporting this view that one can use proline mesh intraperitoneally for intraperitoneal, you know, hernia repair? Hello.
Yeah, hey, you're audible.
No, I am audible.
Hello. Yeah. Hello.
Hello. Yes, Nirmal.
Sir, the indication there are, as far as the global literature is concerned, the intraperitoneal use of polypropylene mesh is not advisable. There is significant high risk of all these complications which have been very clearly described. In our personal experience and practice as well, we all have come across the cases where we had to re-enter the and treat the complications of bowel erosions and the obstructions whenever these meshes have been used.
Yes,
so
yes. Whenever
we as a small cohort can experience such complications, the global literature is replete and it is abundant with all kinds of, you know, reports which prevent the use of polypropylene mesh intraperitoneally.
Why I am saying so, because you see, we use sometimes proline mesh for fixing viscera, for example, rectopexy. For this, erosion is very uncommon. It's very uncommon, erosion of the rectum because of the proline mesh. And several times we use proline mesh only. So erosion is unlikely, but yes, adhesion is a great likelihood, as we know about the biology of the mesh, like you explained also. Thank you very much. All these comments I wanted to make.
Thank you, sir. Thank
even
you.
PT, even PTFE mesh, they say it should be avoided intra-abdominally for adhesions. It forms adhesions very tightly.
PTFE, you
have. PTFE
is not. Yeah, PTFE. You have two types.
Polytetra.
Yeah. Polytetrafluoroethylene.
Yeah, it should be also avoided intra-abdominally.
Yeah, Dr.
Polytetrafluoroethylene, which can be used. You know, it is meant for, in fact, the visceral surface of the dual mesh.
Maybe they say generally, if it is a, we can say, it should be a mesh.
Yeah, it should be.
If it is composite, we can use it.
But thought I am telling you, the new information is that there is a type of PTFE which is meant for visceral face of the dual mesh. That is new.
Yes.
That is new information.
New one.
And I am adding. Yes.
Correct.
Yeah,
Dr. Prashant.
Hello.
Let others ask the questions. Yes.
I was listening to this conversation, sir. Nirmal, yeah. It was a very good presentation. I could a few of the comments I would like to make. One is about the Dr. Mishra surgery. I was part of that paper which was published in journal Hernia. Right. Now, Arora sir's question is very pertinent to this. You can use a polypropylene mesh, but if you want to go again inside, there are hell lot of complications because of the adhesions. That is why this putting of PTFE mesh is not advocated. But people are using it, not now, but at that time during our trial of that, because it was a thesis given to one of the students. So we have not gone much inside, but then people who have gone ventured again into inside for the second surgery or third surgery, there were a lot of adhesions and a lot of enterotomies and bowel fistulization. That is why this has gone outside, and this is the only published case or only published case series in the literature in journal Hernia. Second point about ePTFE mesh. ePTFE mesh doesn't produce any of the adhesions. It is because ePTFE mesh is not used because there are no pores. So there is no ingrowth of granulation tissue. So there were two papers in US journal, I don't remember the journals, that has said that because there is no ingrowth of granulation tissue, because there are no pores in this ePTFE mesh, that is why the adhesions or imbibition or imbrication of this mesh into the abdominal wall doesn't occur, which is the pathophysiology which should be used. The mesh should imbricate itself into the anterior abdominal wall by the ingrowth of the granulation tissue, which doesn't happen with ePTFE mesh. Secondly, because there are no pores, so the leukocytes migration between the wall and the mesh occurs, and that leads to a lot of infections. And that is why this ePTFE mesh is not used.
Deep, hello, Prashant. Hello.
Yes, yes, I am hearing you.
Prashant, it is basically it does not get incorporated, but it gets encapsulated. So that is the word. PTFE mesh get encapsulated, it doesn't get incorporated into the tissues. So that is the reason it is not advisable to use PTFE mesh. It is not being used very commonly.
Totally agree. Nirmal, Nirmal, one question to you.
Yes.
Now I have seen. What do you think? Is there an ideal mesh, or is there an ideal tacker?
No. That I've already covered
amongst,
in my presentation.
Amongst all the tackers which you have presented and all the mesh you have presented, is there an ideal mesh or is there an ideal tacker, or still the weight is on?
An ideal mesh does not exist, right? That is what the confusion was. That is what my confusion was. An ideal mesh does not exist. Neither does an ideal fixation device exist. Whatever we have to choose is between, you know,
We lost your audio.
And now you are audible.
So whatever decision we are going to make is based on whatever the information which we have gathered so far, understanding the pathophysiology and understanding the inherent properties of a particular device. So that is what is going to decide a particular thing.
Right.
I think the better will be whatever the thing you are comfortable with and using since long, I think that will go on. It depends upon your own experience, which you have a less irritant, less infections, less recurrences. I think you can continue to use that.
Yeah, Dr. Kaustubh Salda. Question from Dr. Kaustubh Salda. Please unmute yourself. Kaustubh sir.
Hello.
Yeah.
Aaj continue.
Yes. Good evening, sir. Nirmal sir, it was very nice presentation. I just want to ask, should we prescribe anti-inflammatory in post-operative hernia? As you told that collagen 1 and collagen 3 ratio is altered with the in the recurrent hernias. So if we prescribe anti-inflammatory like trypsin, chymotrypsin and bromelain.
These are anti-enzymatics. They have not been directly implicated in whatever the wound healing has been, you know, described. The collagen or the type 1 or type 3 collagen is not affected by the, you know, use of trypsin, chymotrypsin. And these are, you know, even otherwise for anti, as an anti-inflammatory, I really have doubts in what form the enzyme is being ingested and in what form it reaches the tissue. So as far as the literature is also concerned, there is no mention of any use or against the use of these anti-inflammatory agents in the case of hernia. As far as other NSAIDs and anti-inflammatory is concerned, yes, you have to use because you have to make the patient comfortable so that the patient have a bearable pain in the post-operative period.
Right, sir. Right.
We have a question from Subhashri. Dr. Subhashri
Pagay. Yeah, Subhashri Pagay. See the PG.
Yeah. Okay, Subhashri Pagay, you have a question. Please ask your question. Please unmute yourself.
Hello.
Hello.
Continue.
Good evening, sir. Sir, my question is, like, suppose we are dealing with a case of recurrence of inguinal hernia. A patient was previously repaired with a proline mesh. Now, when we are dealing the recurrence, and suppose we are planning to do the surgery by open method, what should be the preferred mesh in this case? Like, since there will be lots of previous adhesions here.
No. As far as the repair of recurrent inguinal hernias is concerned, the dictum is if the previous repair was open repair, now you have to go laparoscopically because the preperitoneal plane would still be virgin in such cases, right? As against if a previous hernia repair was laparoscopic, you now have to go in, you know, preferably by a open method so that again you get niche areas and clean areas for dissection and delineation of the defects and a proper tissue repair. So the use and the choice of the type of mesh is not affected by the recurrence. It was not because of the proline mesh which the hernia got recurred. It was basically because of some missed hernia or mesh migration or improper size of the mesh or improper fixation of the mesh. So the choice of mesh is not, it should not be, you know, it should not change with the recurrence of the hernia. The approach must change.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Next question is from Dr. Amit Pujari. Dr. Amit Pujari, please unmute your mic.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, yeah, you are audible.
Yeah, good. Yeah, Nirmal sir, it was a fantastic presentation as always from you.
Thank you, Amit.
This is a question which is actually troubling me since a lot of years. You mentioned that there are different classifications of mesh as per their weight, and there are different meshes as per their pore size. Now, the thing which is troubling me a lot is then when I shifted from a microporous heavy mesh to a large pore ultralight mesh, I got 3 mesh failures and recurrence, and I was the unfortunate surgeon who got to operate them again. Now, I would like to know, how do you select as per the weight of the mesh and the pore size? What is your recommendation?
Pore size should be of about 1 mm or more, right?
Okay.
The selection of the material is important. It should have a monofilamentous polypropylene or polyester based mesh. The chances of a mesh getting failed, was it a burst mesh or the mesh had given?
It was a burst mesh.
As far as the literature is concerned, Amit, even the ultra pro mesh will sustain a 650 mmHg of intra-abdominal pressure. So that is basically more than 4 times what a maximum intra-abdominal pressure can be generated.
Yes.
So ideally, it should not.
Yeah, ideally should not. That was the thing for me. And about the second question, you mentioned that there is a tensile strength in the mesh across the 2 dimensions, maximum and minimum. Now, most of the mesh materials and the companies, they do not mention this to us. How to find it out?
Now,
because I think that is very important even in laparoscopic hernia also.
Yes. Whenever you are using a polypropylene mesh, suppose a proline mesh you are using, if you see the, you know, if you look at it closely, it will have uniformity in one direction. And if you try to stretch it, it will be more stretchable in one direction rather than perpendicular to it. So the more stretchable part, if you're making a rectangular shape out of that mesh, that more stretchable part has to lie horizontally. right?
Okay.
As against
okay.
a perpendicular. This is in the case of
okay.
inguinal hernia. As against
yeah.
a ventral
yeah.
hernia, which is you know elongated,
yeah.
is having an oval
yes.
shape. So the maximum
yes.
tensile strength of that longitudinally you know stretchable axis should be along the longer axis of the hernial orifice. So hernial defect.
Okay.
So that it has
okay.
to resist. You know, it can compensate.
Okay.
So that is
thank you.
The anisometry. Yeah, that is
okay.
A point which has to be you know an information has to be gathered from the company people, which you has very rightly said that they do not tell us.
Yeah, they don't tell us. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Most of the questions are over now. There is no more hand which is being raised here. So concluding comments or concluding remarks from our panelist.
Yeah, I'll say that but the best thing will be ultimately rather than said, we have your evidence-based medicine, which is coming everywhere. It is said that have experience, whatever the best available and what is best suits to your patients. Let them have the choice. And then your experience will tell you that what are you using? You should be continuing with that because your experience is ultimately going to tell how many recurrences you have, how much your patient have suffered. I think that is the best. Instead of going to jumping here and there, you should stick to what you are using since long and you are comfortable with.
Right.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dilip Gupta, sir. Thank you, Nirmal, sir, for that awesome presentation.
Thank you so much.
Just for information to all of the attendees right now, next week we are having a session on sterilization of OT equipments. I'll put that notice in the group also. So see you next week on Saturday.
Right.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you very much, Dr. Yogesh and the team to give an opportunity for this. Being a panelist.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you, the office bearers of BSA and ASN once again for you know allowing for this opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nirmal.
Okay.
Bye.
Good night, everybody.